Robert and I, as you probably all well know, we go back quite a number of years. We have a very similar passion for our industry. We both love our industry very much, and there's other members of our folk here that are in the same category, I must say. But his topic tonight really gives a good descriptive of who we are and what we are. It's a question that haunts me over many years, and a thing called professionalism, and what the profession is, and sort of define our roots and where we sort of come from. And more importantly, I think if you're left with a question, is where are we going? I mean, I amongst you all intimately, I sort of talk about merging the architects and builders together. There's a few other groups amongst that cohort as well of architects and builders, certifiers and engineers and what have you. But there is a bit of a change, a metamorphosis happening out there in the industry, and it's we've got to sort of recognize the fact that maybe we have to sort of start working more closely together. And I think with Robert's words tonight, it'll give you a bit of an insight of where we came from, where that exactly took place, because once upon a time we were a different animal, and what we are to what we are today. And you know, we might sort of go back to the way it was all those years ago. That's just food for thought for all of you, but we are in this transitional stage, I believe, and I think it'd be really great to hear Robert's words and what he has to say. Now, I better give the traditional owners, so let's get started. The University of Newcastle respectively acknowledges the traditional custodian, the Wabakal people, on whose traditional land this town hall is located. And I respectfully respect past and present members of that clan. Now, a bit of a background for Robert, and I've got a 4-page CV, which I'm not going to read out. It is rather large. Now, with a 4-page CV, is quite a quite an incredible young man, I have to say, and I can say that young man because he's a bit younger than I am. But he's done very well in the span of life that he has. Bob's sort of entered the industry back in 81. I think it was with Leighton Industries, would that be right?
Yes, Leighton's? Total Project Control.
Leighton's over at the casino in Sydney, as I understand it.
Shortly after, yes.
Shortly after, yeah. And from there, he's a passionate builder, Bob, even at his own home. And if you notice that little flyer that you all saw, you saw Bob at this bridge. And I've seen this bridge, I've been to his home, and I said, oh, it's quite an impressive little bridge he built. And he organized the TAFE students and himself and organized funding for it. And it's a lovely stone, heritage type design bridge that he designed himself and organized construction of by students and himself. And it's a sort of medieval type bridge, which sort of really reflects his landscaping that Bob's been working on his own private castle that he has over at Lura. And it's just beautiful, actually. He's got all this landscape garden that's very much Castilian, you know, using the old English sort of vibe. It's rather beautiful. And this bridge that he created as a public pathway from one side of this gorge in Lura for the people in the surrounding areas. It's a lovely dedication he gave to the locals, and it's been appreciated by the locals as well. So it's in Bob's inherent nature to do these wonderful things, and his passion is very much reflects in what he currently does today. Now, Bob's a builder, and Sir Lawrence Street used to call him Bob the Builder, for those of you who don't know Sir Lawrence, but he's a lovely old chappy, and every time he saw Bob, here comes Bob the Builder. But Bob's also a certifier by background also, so he covers a few dimensions in his credibility, and he's been recognized for that, and he's a profound exponent of the National Building Professionals Registry, which I am as well, and both he and I are both members on three grades on that registry, which is good. Now, to his credit, of course, he's got his academic qualifications, obviously, as well, but more so to his credit, he received a member of the Order of Australia, an MA, for his services to the construction industry, and for that he should really be applauded. And so I won't say any more about that, and I think it's a wonderful contribution Bob has made for our industry. It's ongoing, and one thing I try to encourage everybody in industry to get involved, and he's a fine example of that, to really give back for us oldies, to give back in particular, but for you young folks also to get involved with the industry. And by getting involved, it just opens up your door to so many opportunities. The opportunities are tremendous But you'll only really recognise them when you really get involved with the industry. And to get involved, that's very bright, that light. But to get involved, you're going to have this internal passion. Whatever you do, architecture, engineering, building, doesn't really matter what you want to do. But to really get that passion into you and get involved with the industry, the rewards are there. Don't chase the dollar, the dollars will come. But really get involved with the industry and have that passion for it, and you'll be all very successful. So without any further to do, one more thing I have to do is recognize the sponsors for tonight, which is also very important. Without them, we wouldn't have tonight. So our gold sponsor tonight is BK Architecture and CSI Hebel, that you have on the side there. Our silver sponsor for tonight is Hunter Development Corporation. The City of Newcastle for the venue that we have here tonight, and Nagisa Japanese restaurant, Nagisa, I think I say it in Japanese, Nagisa Japanese restaurant, and Miria Park Wines for the Catering and Architecture Foundation for the hands and support. For them, I thank them, and I'll now ask Bob to come forward and present his talk for us. Thank you very much, Bob.
Thank you very much for the kind words, John. And can I say, thank you to all the people here and the university. For some reason, you guys have been particularly kind to me over the years, and it is very much appreciated. Whilst dealing with such things before getting to the topic at hand, I thought I'd briefly explain my viewpoint in the world. I left school in 1979. I did a year of architecture, believe it or not, at the Uni of New South Wales. There was the late, great Barry Wollaston, who taught construction. I got him. There's a couple other people who are still practicing who I won't mention, which I didn't get, but treated me awfully kind as well. And it was the day I got a high distinction for drawing 500 lines and 500 pieces of paper, a complete ream, 100 in charcoal, post office pen and ink, crayon, pencil and so forth. I looked at my work on the studio wall and went, screw it, who do I know who's going to pay me for this? That isn't meant to be a derogatory comment. That is meant to be a statement of fact, which it is. Because being a lad from Bankstown, I had never met an architect. Architects sounded great to me. And I preface my talk by saying some of the things which I'm going to be saying tonight might sound a bit rough when you first hear it from other professions. Okay? It is not intended to be that way at all. Tonight, I will seek to explain why our industry's practitioners are regulated and regulated in so many different ways across the nation. I will seek to explain why the successful completion of your studies, for those of you who are students here, matters not only to you, but to other practitioners. It matters to me. It matters to the broader community, and it matters to industry. We need competent architects. We need the flashiest architects and engineers we can get. We also need the flashiest builders we can get, and we'll come back as to what we'll define as building a bit later. In doing so, I hope that you will get some additional insights into what learned opinion is actually worth, because lo and behold, licenses, consultancy, accreditation does have a certain cash value. My licenses earn me my quid, not any accolade. We'll come back to that if we have time. Okay, who's actually worth? So when you engage a consultant or a license holder or some other accredited individual, the idea is so that you guys will actually know what it is you're getting. So you don't have false expectations, not to deride people, so you know what you're getting for your money, no more, no less. In doing so, we'll first examine, I guess a better way of saying it is I'll provide a brief overview of the history of our industry. And some of this history will go way back, and I mean way back. Now hopefully that will only take no longer than 20, 25 minutes, because I got told I should talk for 50. And then we'll have a bit more of discussion. Now, on this wonderful contraption called a computer, which all the clever people came up with, zillions of files just for tonight. No, I've got no intention of taking you through all of them. But they're there to provide proof of anything I say. Because some of what I will say will be a bit confronting. It was to a person the other day, which surprised me somewhat. Now, we will have discussions, as John said, about what constitutes a profession or a professional. Now, in our industry, the difference between a trade and a profession is well known. There was a chap by the name of Henry Yeville. Let's see if we can get that up. And Henry Yeville, at various times called a builder, master mason, and latterly an architect, which is the subject matter I'll return to, was in fact a contractor. He was a building contractor. And he was engaged by this bloke. That's the only contemporaneous picture of Richard II. So as I said, we're going to go way back. Whoopsie daisy, we don't want to go quite that back. I will now hit, what do we do, hit scope? Technical person coming up. Where's the exit? Oh, I got it. Beautiful. Okay, doke. He was a contractor. He had the contract to build Westminster Hall. Westminster Hall is still there to rebuild it after a fire. Now, he had the contract, but Hugh Herland had the subcontract to build that beautiful hammer beam roof. Hugh Herland was the royal carpenter. That was his gig. Okay? It's still there, it's beautiful, it's gorgeous, hammer beam roof. But it was Mr. Yeville who took responsibility for the project as a whole, including the financial responsibility for it. As we hit, did I hit? Forgive me, guys. Okay. So, and again, we'll do it again.
Red X.
Huh?
Go to the red X.
I think that's the way to go. Thank you very much. I don't know why my two daughters think their father's slow. But they were right. But regulation of a building contractor goes way back further than Richard II. Okay? Now, it goes back to the Code of Hammurabi. Now, would you believe there's a nice little picture of Hammurabi? See, Daisy? Did we get the right one? No, we didn't get the right one. We must be this one. There he is. Okay. Now, it's often cited that his laws were the oldest bit of legislation ever recorded in the world, but there's actually two other pieces which are a bit older. Okay. Now, his laws, well, they were predated, but let's deal with the chase. They were predated by this chap, a Sumerian king by the name of Nemu, who oddly enough came from the city of Ur. And that dates back to the 21st century BC. And there's also evidence of the Sumerian code of Lipidishim, and all that's great. And that's all 200 years before Hammurabi. Now, I say all that because all their codes have a striking familiarity. But let's get back to Hammurabi. This chap was the sixth king of the first Babylonian dynasty, would you believe? Now, like me, when I first heard this, I said, "Screw, it was a Babylonian dynasty." Quick, go and have a look at the dictionary of, check the word dynasty, and see where the heck Babylon was. Yes, you guessed it, the Iraq, Tigris, and Euphrates. He reigned from 1792 BC to 1750. Now, of the 282 laws in his code, they were the first for scaled punishments, you know, the eye for the eye concept. Nearly one half of his code deals with matter of contract, establishing the wages to be paid for an ox driver, for example, as opposed to a surgeon. A third of the code deals with, well, household matters, really, family relationships, inheritance, divorce, paternity, even sexual behaviour. Family law courts, only 4,000 years back. Only one provision was there for the obligations on an official, i.e. if a judge came up with a wrong decision, he is to be fined and removed from the bench permanently. But we don't really care too much that. We want to worry about his laws pertaining to building. So, as we hit that again, if I was to now call up that beast, and let's hope we get it. Oopsie daisy. First of all, for the sake of the record, the next time you're in Paris and want to look at the Louvre, you can find his laws written on this beautiful stone tablet in the shape of a finger. On the reverse side, instead of a fingernail, there's a nice carving, Mr. Hammurabi. But let's have a look at what he said about builders, shall we? He stipulated in Law 228, if a builder build a house for the same one and complete it, he shall give him a fee of 2 shekels in money for each sar of surface. Okay. Now, sar of surface is disputed what that means, but basically go with square metre of floor area per floor. If a builder built a house for someone and does not construct it properly, the house in which he built it falls in and kills its owner, then the builder shall be put to death. If it kills the son of the owner, then the son of the builder shall be put to death. If it kill a slave of the owner, then he shall pay slave for slave to the owner of the house. And 232 is still with us. If it ruins the goods, he shall make compensation for that has been ruined. And inasmuch as he did not construct properly this house which he built and it fell, he shall re-erect the house from his own means. 4,000 years ago, thereabouts. Breathtaking stuff. Now, I ask you to bear in that in mind, because when I first looked at it, I've got to thank the late, great Peter Brown, he who wrote the, you know, the little, those of you who constructed a little textbook, Analytical Approach to Building Estimating. Yeah. He was a nice old codger, tough as nails. Well, when I, you know, I first came across it, I said, well, heck, why aren't engineers and architects in the gun, son? That was my reaction. Now, Peter referred me to Shakespeare. I said, get out of here. I remember this at the time. This was after my year of architecture, I might add. This is my first year of building, 81. I said, get out of here. He said, well, Shakespeare's got all the answers to life. Go and have a look. I'll give you a tip. It's in Henry IV. Quickly look up who the heck Henry IV was. And lo and behold, the great man was right. He did have something to say. I'm going to scroll this down as we read it together. In Henry IV, Shakespeare used construction as a metaphor for war. When we first mean to build, we first survey the plot, then draw the model. And when we see the figure of the house, then we must rate the cost of erection. What if we find outweighs our ability? What do we do but draw anew the model in fewer offices, or at least desist to build at all? Much more in this great work, which is almost to luck a kingdom down and set another up, should we survey the plot of our situation and the model, consent upon a sure foundation, question our surveyors, now know our own estate, how able such work to undergo, to weigh against the opposite, or else fortify with paper and with figures, using the names of men instead of men. Well, like one who draws the model of a house beyond his limit or his power to build it, who half through gives over and leaves this part created cost, a naked subject to the weeping clouds and the waste for sureless winter's tyranny. I reckon that's a pretty good description of owner builders, don't you? Now, again, I ask myself the question, and old Peter, how does what's the point you're trying to make to me, Peter? He says, well, it's like this. Shakespeare talked about builders and quantity surveys. He didn't talk about architects or engineers. Again, I was, you know, early comment with Hammer Abbey. I said, well, how come? Because they didn't damn well exist, Bob. And that was a shock. Now, surprisingly to some, they didn't exist. And I'm not saying there was no architecture or no clever people coming up with engineering design, as what we now know. But the first modern publication about architecture was by Palladio, his Quattro Libri dell'Architettura, the four books of architecture. I murdered that, didn't I? Which spread his influence. Well, architects are very good in self-promotion. I mean, that builder's going to learn a thing or two. Okay, and it became known as his architectural treatise. However, the first book was not published in English until 1663, well after Shakespeare's time. You getting where I'm coming at? Okay. And lo and behold, and that was a London edition by Godfrey Richards. Okay. And it was probably just in time, just before the Great Fire of London, so this is all good stuff. But the first complete English language edition wasn't published until 1716 in English. By another Italian by the name of Giacomo Leone. Now, it's a magnificent publication. There, that's what it looks like. That was the cover piece at the time. A lot of heartfelt effort. And this was about educating people in design. We'll come back to that. So, before this period, you didn't have architects and engineers. Now, I've got to say, Henry VIII, predating Shakespeare, did have one bloke called the Architectus. And he was to advise the king on architecture and music. Sorry, buildings and music. Now, after Henry VIII, that term stayed dormant for a little while. Right? No problem with that. Okay? But the Renaissance did bring a lot of foreign ideas to the English-speaking world. This is why it's called the Renaissance. It's a spread of ideas. They're good things. Mr. Palladio's books are marvellous. Some of you might have, you know, copies of reprints in your library. I know I do. Okay? But, okay, the terms architect and engineer that we know and enjoy today are largely 19th century constructs. And those constructs don't necessarily, rightfully or wrongfully, who cares, hold water today. And whilst we are at it, and this is the one that upsets people, the so-called architect Sir Christopher Wren, a fellow and president of the Royal Society of London, who was responsible for much of the new and rebuilding after the Great Fire, was in fact no such thing. Because apart from being a physics professor, his position when he designed the current St. Paul's Cathedral was actually Surveyor General. That position as such, that we know and love since, didn't exist back then. Now that's different to our current Surveyor General of the State of New South Wales, one Des Mooney, who regulates land surveys. Okay? But I put it to you, it's kind of curious over the years, and this is the builder having a chip on his shoulder, how the works of others get appropriated to one from profession to the next. Well, these things happen. But I was bringing to you that wonderful, wonderful, and I'll go back to it again. Most of us only got to discover the work of Christopher Wren in our studies, and I'll leave it at this size, there's not much point blowing up. When we saw this beautiful diagram produced by Mr. William Dunn, fellow of the Royal Institute of British Architects, I'm about to pay a compliment to an engineer. Look at the engineering involved. You've got a lantern at the top, which various reports, anyone been there and walked around? Yeah, that lantern at the top weighs a couple of hundred tons. It's not a light little thing. It's supported by a cone. The cone's got a couple of steel chains going around it, so it doesn't spread. The dome's inside, internal and external, are decorative. I'd say functional, because they serve a purpose. But the engineering in it is brilliant. But then again, he was a physics professor. And that was a rather unique solution for a dome, but we don't have time to discuss various other domes at the moment. Similarly, much earlier, Edward I led a contract of £50, apparently in addition to the chap's stipend, for the design and construction of 8 castles, including Harling, Beaumaris and others, in Wales, to the builder James of St. George. These days referred to as an architect and military engineer. We'll come back to that term. Because, I'll be candid with you, people can't quite bring themselves to use the word builder. But in fact, he was a contractor. Builders today sign, design and construct contracts, not architects. Now, that isn't having a go at architects, as I go to get the right one again. If we were to have a look at his work, and there is a great picture of the great man getting his instructions from Eddie I, I ask you to have a look at this note, and this is from McNeil's publication, 92, which the builder here, James, was pleading for some more money. In case you wonder where so much money could go in a week, we would have you know that we have needed 400 masons, both cutters and layers, together with 2,000 less skilled workmen, 100 carts, 60 wagons and 30 boats bringing stone, and sea coal, 200 quarrymen, 30 smiths, and carpenters for putting in joists and floorboards and other necessary jobs. All this takes no account of the garrison mentioned before, nor the purchase of the material, of which there will be have to be a great quantity. The men's pay has been and is still very much in arrears, and we are having the greatest difficulty in keeping them because they simply have nothing to live on. And this isn't a shot across the bow. Let me know when the last time you heard an architect or an engineer concerned about such things. This is a classic builder doing a design and construct contract. So let's talk about other professions. I sounded like I just bagged architects, and I don't, because architects are worth their weight in gold. Let's make no mistake about that. So, engineers. Before there were civil engineers, there was military engineering. Ooh, nice big echo. And military engineering is loosely defined as the art and practice of designing and building military works and maintaining lines of military transport and communications. Military engineers are responsible for logistics behind military tactics. Modern military engineering differs from civil engineering. In the 20th and 21st centuries, military engineering also includes other disciplines such as mechanical and electrical engineering techniques. According to NATO, military engineering is that engineer activity undertaken, regardless of component of service, to shape the physical operating environment. Military engineering incorporates support to maneuver and to force as a whole, including military engineering functions such as engineer support to force protection, counter-improvised explosive devices, environmental protection, engineer intelligence and military search. Military engineering does not encompass the activities undertaken by those engineers who maintain and repair and operate vehicles, vessels, aircraft, weapon systems and equipment. My father was one of the latter, but we'll come back to that. The word engineer was initially used in the context of warfare, dating back to 1325, again around Richard II's time, that pasty-faced young chap we saw in the first picture, when engineer, and I can't pronounce it with a French accent, but Richard II spoke French, not English. Okay. Literally, one who operates an engine referred to a constructor of military machines. These days, people say, oh, it's based on being clever. It's based on the Latin word for ingenious. I don't know. It sounds like a good word to me. Okay. Referred to a constructor of military machines. In this context, well, the engine of war, equipment of war, catapults and the like. However, as the design of civilian structures, such as bridges and buildings, matured as a technical discipline, the term civil engineering entered the lexicon as a way to distinguish those specialising in the construction of such non-military projects and those involved in the older discipline. As the prevalence of civil engineering outstripped engineering in a military context and the number of disciplines expanded, the original military meaning of the word engineering is pretty much obsolete. In its place, the term military engineering is now used, you use the adjective to describe it. In the 18th century, the term civil engineering was coined to incorporate all things civilian as opposed to military engineering. Now the first, and I want to emphasize, self-proclaimed civil engineer was one John Smeaton. There he is. Okay. And this was great. This is what he wanted to do. He wanted to build things. Some of the things that he built, credit where credit due, were quite clever. The Edison Lighthouse, there's the original design. That's what's left of it now. Think about this, building high tide. It's a classical exercise. A couple of years ago, the Building Professional of the Year under the Institute of Building got his accolade for building or fixing up that lighthouse up at Queensland, a heritage listed building. He could only access the site a couple of times a day, and him and his team of five did quite spectacular work. Now, in 1771, and yes, it is 1771, and I'll come back to his little prefixes here. Smeaton and some of his colleagues formed the Smeatonian Society of Civil Engineers. Isn't that correct? He was modest. Okay. Now, they were a group of leaders of that profession who met informally over dinner. It was really just a social group. But the chat was, like Christopher Wren, a fellow of the Royal Society. And to use the Royal Society's full name, it's the Royal Society of London, not to be confused with the one of Edinburgh or the one in New South Wales, which has been going for 200 years. So let's give credit where credit's due. The man is quite clever. But the other granddaddy of the engineering profession is one Thomas Telford. Now, Thomas actually helped define what engineering is. There he is. Okay. Royal Society of Engineers. We'll come back to that in half a tick. He is described in textbooks as, quote, a Scottish civil engineer, comma, architect, comma, and stonemason. They didn't need the second comma. And is noted road and bridge and canal builder. Now, he defined engineering, civil engineering, as the art of directing the great sources of power in nature for the use and convenience of man, as the means of production and of traffic in states, both for the external and internal trade, as applied in the construction of roads, bridges, aqueducts, canals, river navigation, and docks for internal intercourse and exchange, and in the construction of ports, harbours, moles. Couldn't find a definition for moles. Couldn't find a single definition, I read a few. Breakwaters and lighthouses, and in the art of navigation by artificial power for the purposes of commerce. He was talking about candles, literally. And in the construction and application of machinery and in the drainage of cities and towns. Now, I don't think any of us can argue too much with that definition of engineering, can we? I'm happy with that. Okay, not for me to be happy. So we're getting in this situation where we're now in the 1830s. He passed away in the 1830s, and we finally got a definition of engineering. For the record, the Telford Medal still remains the highest award that an engineer can get internationally. I guess it's like their Nobel Prize. I only say that because, John, there's one chap that you and I both know who's got one. And that's a good Dr. Alan Geary AO. And he got that about 30, 40 years ago. So let's now talk briefly about building surveying, just to round off this history. Again, I'll look to the British Isles. Well, I've got to tell you this, fellas, I speak English. I've got limited ability, can't speak any others. But it has a long history of legal controls on building construction. And there's a great wealth of records available for those. Now, architectural historians refer to this. I don't quite understand the difference between an architectural historian and a building historian, but again, that's my limit. But let's look at where it all began, and you guessed it, London. The densely packed housing of that capital created problems which could only be tackled communally, i.e. a house could block the light from its neighbours, thin party walls and badly sited privies and gutters were often nuisances. These issues were first tackled, a set of regulations dated to 1189. Right? And that is 1189 date is given, quoted by later documents after that date, but the earliest document they got their hands on is 1216. The greatest hazard was, of course, fire, and there was a major fire in 1212. Thatch roofs were subsequently banned in London by the city's first mayor, Henry Fitzwilliam. Complaints about building nuisance could be brought by one neighbour against another. The mayor and the aldermen settled such cases in a court called the Assize of Nuisance. Their judgments survive all the way back to 1301. They were advised by masons and carpenters who were appointed as viewers, whose reports are preserved. Other British cities followed London's lead. And the emphasis here is on city, because even in this country, until comparatively recently, 2005, all building certifiers were employed by council. It's a recent phenomenon, having private certifiers. As early as 1391, Bristol had a viewer who inspected buildings for encroachments onto the street. Worcester's ordinances of 1467 showed concern for the dangers of fire. Thatched houses and timber chimneys were not allowed within the walls. Stone, brick and tile were safe materials within urban areas. But we know timber framing, you know, persisted and it's rather gorgeous, and heck, we still use it in a practical sense today. But the big change happened in the wake of the Great Fire of London in 1661, which wiped out 80% of the then city. That disaster led to the London Building Act of 1667, the first to provide for surveyors by name to enforce its regulations. It laid down that all houses were to be built of brick or stone. The number of stories and width of walls were carefully specified. Streets should be wide enough to act as fire breaks. The first act applied to the walled city of London. The Building Acts of 1707 and 1709 extended that control to Westminster. Yes, where Parliament is, that was a different city. They added a prohibition of timber cornices and required brick parapets to rise 2.5 feet above the garret floor. A comprehensive act in 1774 covered the whole built-up area. First bit of town planning, or in the modern sense. Its detailed set of regulations include the stipulation that doors and windows should be recessed at least 4 inches. For those of you who are somewhat younger than me, that's 100 mil. Okay, from the front of the building. The statute set the fashion, which was soon emulated throughout that country. And yes, POMs being POMs, have a complete set of record of the time. Now, ladies and gentlemen, they say the past is another country, literally in this case. And I put it to you, we don't really care too much after that, because let's face it, the sovereign state of New South Wales has had responsible self-government since 1856. Pause. That's a formal part of this, of the talk, but let's talk about the discussion. Ladies and gentlemen, and the builders know this, so forgive me for going over this. It is the builder who has a statutory responsibility for the design of the product. To this day. I call your attention to section 18F of the New South Wales Home Building Act. Now, some of us are rather proud of this, and I'll explain why in half a tick. Because we finally had, for the first time, defences for a builder. 2014, we finally got this up. In proceedings for a breach of statutory warranty, i.e. building's right, it is a defence for the defendant to prove that the deficiencies for which the plaintiff complains arise from instructions by the person for whom the work was contracted to be done contrary to the advice of the defendant, i.e. I'm the builder and I've told the client that you got bum advice. That's a bit hard for somebody with a trade in a Cert 4, and if it happens, and I'm not going to pick on Glenn Burke, but I'll use him as an example. Glenn's giving the advice. On a bright side, Glenn wouldn't make a sum up. Okay? Being advice given in writing before the work has been carried out. So the young players, I build something for you. I don't tell you to tell your client that the work is mucked up. I can't even claim a variation for it when I have to redo it. But this is the best we got. A reasonable reliance by the defendant on instructions given by a person who is relevant, who is a relevant professional, acting for the person for whom the work was contracted to be done, and who is independent of the defendant, being instructions given in writing before the work was done, and big on that again, confirmed in writing after the work was done.
It gets better.
A relevant professional is not independent of the defendant if it is established that the relevant professional was engaged. So if I went and had employed the architect or engineer, I got no defence. Let's say that again. If I engage the architect or engineer and they stuffed up, builder has no defence. I can't go and claim it. There'll be other matters I could raise with such people. Torts under the Commonwealth Trade Practices Act, but we won't get too far into it. Okay? Or was engaged on the basis of a recommendation. So I recommended one of you bright young things to my client, Trevor over there. Trevor's just going to say, well, that's great, Bob. I want to fix now, and you can do it because you're not going to get a claim out of me for it. Okay? Or is or was within 3 years before the relevant instructions were issued a close associate with the defendant. So again, to the young players, I had a beer with you 2.5 years ago, and somebody saw me do it. You're now a close associate, you're no longer independent of me. It doesn't hurt you, it mucks up me big time. Okay? And in this section, a relevant professional means a person who represents him or herself to be an architect, engineer, or surveyor, or represents him or herself to have an expert or specialised qualifications or knowledge in respect to residential building work. And I want to emphasise, fellas, it says residential building work. It does not say house building work. Let's do that again. It does not say house building work. Okay. Any particular aspect of residential building work, or represents him or herself to be engaged in a profession. So they weren't an architect, but they just led me on. Okay? So it is to this day, the builder who has a statutory warranty on the design of the end product, which he or she cannot escape, the fact that others might get their tails kicked in the meantime is besides the point. But I can't duck shovel. Now, usually at this point, ladies and gentlemen, again, we're talking about Australia. We're talking at 6:47 p.m. on the 27th of July, my lovely daughter's 20th birthday today. Right? And usually people turn around and say, well, Bobby, that's great. Marvellous stuff. So tell me, that's New South Wales. Why is this the case in New South Wales? I'm acutely aware of the time. I'm around over on the history part. Because we live in a federation. And Section 51 of the Australian Constitution gives the powers of the Commonwealth. They do not include land use. They do not include builder's licensing, architect's license, or any occupational licensing. So it isn't going to happen. Next, when the government thought about doing such things, it was met with resistance. To name drop, Mr. Michigan, the WA Attorney General and Minister of Commerce responsible for builders' licensing, said to me, "Well, buddy, it's like this, I'm the Minister for Western Australia. We'll do what we damn well want." Western Australia introduced builders' licensing in 1939. Tasmania didn't introduce it until 2004. Tassie's the second oldest state. The reasons why WA introduced builders' licensing in 1938, when you're going back and look at the so-called Hansard record in the second reading, was to safeguard the local industry from the cheap influx, from the influx of cheap labour from Southern Europe. I've got news for you, fellas. If you went from Southern Europe and you're not from an Anglo-Celtic background, you weren't even on their radar, so it wasn't aimed at you. But Tassie got by without introducing it until 2004. Again, I'm acutely aware of the time. Are you aware, fellas, that engineering remains unregulated outside the sovereign state of Queensland? Anyone can call themselves an engineer in New South Wales, always could. But if you were to call yourself an architect, and I mean this nicely about that, if I can drag it out on that. Am I finding? Oh yeah, here we are. There's similar legislation in every state. This is from an older copy from the 2003 Act, but it existed right back in 1921.
You might call yourself an architect because you've got a wonderful master's degree in architecture, 20 years experience. Guess what will happen to you if you're not registered? Here's your $11,000 fine. That's the law. There are a couple of provisions for
other uses of the word architect. They talk about architectural services and so forth. But the tower for business as an architect, I'll rephrase it, before 2003 was the tower for business as an architect. Since 2003, just to call yourself an architect is an offence. I call you an architect, and I know you're not an architect, I'm committing the offence, you don't correct me, we both committed an offence, we're both liable to an 11 grand fine each. This is the way things are. You're going to have to ask yourself, well, that's great, Bob, but what does that mean? I'll be candid with you, I don't actually know. Because it's similar legislation in other states, and again the time, I've got a document there from the South Australian regulator who particularly gives the example, so you've got a master's degree in architecture and 30 years experience, can I call yourself an architect if you're not registered? They say no. But an architect doesn't qualify for a building. I'll rephrase it, architectural qualifications of themselves do not get you to the starting line for a builder's license outside of WA and New South Wales. In New South Wales, you need to search for a building. An engineering degree, and engineers don't exist in this state, doesn't get you a builder's license outside the ACT or WA. My late uncle gave me a call from Tassie, he'd been on the council for 20 years, he was building a hangar at his airstrip. He said, Bob, what's all this? I've got to go and get an architect, an engineer to inspect my hangar to certify the structure. I've never heard of such a thing in all my years on council. But as I said, I didn't introduce any form of licensing until 2004. So the trap is, and again, conscious of time, it goes like this. If you choose or think you can abrogate your responsibility to your client by engaging a consultant, the answer is, in 12-foot high letters, no. If you're a certifier, and you're a poor little thing, and you've got a TAFE call, and you're an A2 certifier, and you engage two PhDs to do, certify the engineering, the structure's okay, the C7 certified, guess who's liable? It ain't the blokes with the PhDs, because that's why they're the principal certifier. So I encourage you to be very precise, because the history lesson today is purely to show you that the terms that we are now commonly use and throw about, they're not meaningless. Can I emphasise that? But they do not mean what you necessarily thought they would mean. An engineer's certification of your house when he comes through and inspects it means diddly squat. Now, I could go still further and bring up the New South Wales engineering degree. They don't do the timber engineering code, or the timber frame code, or anything on the building fabric. But I'm about to give a plug for the architects. At least the architects do a lot more construction than the engineers, which is a bit of a shock. Which is a heck of a shock. There just isn't the substance behind it. And that's why that's reflected in the legislation. Right. So, the reoccurring theme, ladies and gentlemen, and I think I've run over time because it's 6:47 or 6:51, is do what Shakespeare said. Know your own estate. Check your own resources. See if you're actually capable of doing this. And see if the people you're engaging to give learned opinion, expert opinion, are actually in the position to be able to do so. Finally, consultants are worth your while, particularly and only if they come with professional indemnity insurance to share the love. Okay? So for that, after bagging engineers, when you do engage an engineer, you want somebody in the National Engineers Register Category 3. Finally, because I promised people I would, just to understand what actually constitutes building in a legal sense today, as I scrummage for it. For those of you who are unaware, I am a past national president of the Australian Institute of Building. The Australian Institute of Building is one of only 8 outfits with a royal charter, which means each time we change our rules, it's going to be approved by the Office and Department of Prime Minister and Cabinet before being given royal assent. Then it's gazetted and is law. I ask you to have a look at what I've just said in the light of the history. They describe the Institute of Building as the sole chartered institution representing the nation's professional practitioners both within Australia and abroad of all the various disciplines of the building profession, construction and project management, quantity surveying and building economics, building surveying and certification, I couldn't help but underline that one, property and facilities management, house buildings, services, kindred sciences and technologies, construction law, and arbitration. That is the definition of the building profession, as opposed to the architecture profession and the engineering profession that we have just heard. I want to congratulate you all for not falling asleep. But then again, as it's dark, I couldn't quite tell. So thanks for not snoring. Much appreciated. That's all the time permits. Thank you.